Everyone believes in.
Everyone believes in.
Ugh. Okay, let me just knock this one out of the way first. Why did this movie have to be a musical? I feel like the problems this movie has, which we'll get into later, would have been alleviated tremendously if the crooniverse wasn't insistent on shoving 15 songs down our fucking throats.
Son of a rose.
The way the Yellow Diamond sang Rose there sounds very weird and off-key.
Once upon a time, the gem homeworld was ruled by diamonds.
Let's get this one out, too. Why did this movie have to waste 11 minutes on a recap? I get it. You want to try to appeal to the people who are new to the show, but no. No matter how you... Let's get this one out, too. Why did this movie have to waste 11 minutes on a recap? I get it. You want to try to appeal to the people who are new to the show, but no. No matter how you try, trying to shove 5 seasons of story into 11 minutes is going to make things stilted for the new viewer, no matter who they are. Here, let me give an example real quick.
On Earth, she made a new home, new friends, and finally, new life.
This is very dismissive of Pink Diamond's true character. Yeah, let's just ignore the fact that in order for Pink Diamond to have these new friends, she had to create a completely new identity and fool a bunch of gems into becoming freedom fighters against herself? Not to mention, she had to abandon countless individuals to do so, with the show putting emphasis on the diamonds. But of course, the new viewer won't get that, and that's kind of an issue when Spinel is a character in your movie. I remember that before this movie started, there was a documentary-like segment with all the actors and viewers and shit. And near the end of it, Rebecca Sugar came on stage and said that this movie was for the fans. The people who stuck with Steven Universe for the years it's been on air. Okay, so if this movie is for the fans, why are you telling them shit they already know? It just seems counterintuitive to the point of the movie, and it wastes time, which will lead to these inevitable problems that I'll get to.
Come live with us in the palace.
Why did this need to be a song? Get used to this line, you're gonna hear it a lot.
Yes, we know that you're not her, but you were her. You know what it meant to love her, but you remind us so much of her.
Oh, so you've learned nothing. Great.
I've always wanted to go to space camp.
But you've literally been to space multiple times. And you've done way cooler stuff than just camp there.
Steven would be good at CinemaSins. Also, this is a rather convenient way to write Connie out of the conflict for a while. Yeah, fuck being an interesting character to have on board and help Steven when the gems are factory reset. Who needs Connie?
Mwah, okay.
As if writing Connie out of the story for no reason isn't bad enough, this is literally the only form of relationship progression we see. It's quick, it's pointless, and it feels forced in. Christ, way to boil Connie down to just a love interest and nothing else.
Tell everyone at space camp that space used to be super scary and dangerous, but it's great now!
Stroke your ego a little, why don't you?
Here we are in the future.
Why does this need to be a song? Even better, this is just telling us shit we already know, so why does this part even exist, let alone have it be a song? Also, it's been like, what, 2 years now? Why did you feel the need to sing about it now, despite the fact that this happily ever after has lasted for that long? This is the same hand that was destroyed back in Gemglow. Not only that, but it's facing the wrong way, too. Consistency? What's that?
Here we are!
I saved you a seat.
Future vision, millions of possibilities, how did you pick out this one, the concept of improbable futures doesn't count because it was shoehorned in with no rhyme or reason, we never see it come up again. I think you guys get the picture by now.
Sapphire's deadly fate was set until the ruby rushed in told her.
Garnet sounds like she's slurring her words somehow, and it sounds very weird. The crooniverse has proven that they can draw a full set of eyes in faraway shots. Yet here they are, past season 5, still being lazy about it.
Do we all stay just like this forever?
No.
Horseshit. I'm assuming that you use future vision here to know that Steven is going to be in this exact spot when he emerges from Lars. So how the hell did you not see this occurring? Oh, because you didn't look for this instant specific- BULLSHIT! surely you'd be keeping up some kind of check to ensure the Earth isn't endangered again. And you saw this due to how detrimental it could be to the Earth's health. Let me also remind you again that improbable futures don't count. The only way you could have not seen this happening is if you were blatantly ignoring it. Which, may I remind you, seems to be a constant theme with Garnet, and it's kind of a bad quality for Earth's protector to have.
That's right, I heard the story over and over again.
This is one of the only songs that makes sense being here. It's also my third favorite song in the movie due to how fucking catchy it is. Take off some sins, please. Also, Steven's sandal isn't colored in this shot.
You know her, Pearl? Can you tell us who she is?
Pearl, you had a good few seconds there to explain who Spinel was. Why didn't you say anything? It's possible most of this conflict could have been lessened if you did so, and we all know how keen Pearl is on explaining things.
Who am I? Who am I? What are you even saying? I'm the loser of the game. You didn't know you were playing.
You question how he doesn't know who you are. Then you say he doesn't know about the game you and Pink Diamond played? Not to mention, you keep referring to Pink Diamond in the third person, so surely you understand her and Steven are two different people. I smell a contradiction here.
I heard the story, don't really like how it ends. She is swell to finally beat her other.
They had plenty of time to see that was coming. Maybe duck? Dodge? Move in some other direction? Christ, even Steven saw it coming! Why did they just run blindly into someone carrying a scythe? This isn't a result of rustiness, this is just plain incompetence. Also, Spinel's legs completely disappear in this shot, as if she never wrapped them around the drill to begin with. Additionally, Spinel's animation here makes it look like she wrapped her legs around the lighthouse, as she wouldn't be able to stretch towards the gems if they were wrapped around the drill. If Steven's gem has been factory reset, then how can he even begin to summon a bubble in his hands? He didn't really start using that ability until Monster Buddies, and that was 23 episodes in. Also, I feel this is a perfect time to add in that this is where Connie could have proved very useful. Granted, we don't know how the scythe works on full humans, but considering that it only really affected Steven's gem half, Connie could potentially have been unaffected. She could have easily dispatched of Spinel in no time at all, and this conflict would have never happened. When you're writing a story, you need to make sure that stupid little shit like this doesn't completely ruin the plot you're writing. And the fact that you had to write Connie out in a way that even Steven questions shows how underdeveloped this premise was to begin with.
Holy, she really got everybody.
Huh?
See? Here she comes, good old Pearl.
Kinda weird how she questions shows how underdeveloped this premise was to begin with.
Holy, she really got everybody.
Huh?
See? Here she comes, good old Pearl.
Kind questions shows how underdeveloped this premise was to begin with.
Holy, she really got everybody.
Huh?
See? Here she comes, good old Pearl.
Kinda weird how she regenerated before Amethyst.
How do you do?
Why did this need to be a song?
A precious sapphire, she sees the future.
Why are you treating that information like some kind of secret? Also, not a sin, but apparently according to the movie website, a lone sapphire can see the definitive future and not possibilities. Just a note, in a future everything wrong with, I will personally explain why this is a terrible development.
Why would I be mad at my best friend?
Ladies and gentlemen, meet the worst part of this movie's first 52 minutes. Spinel's factory reset form is annoying, it serves no purpose other than to get in the way of the plot, and did I mention she's annoying? I get that's kind of the point, but this made my first watch of this movie fucking infuriating at some points. Crooniverse, lay off a bit.
Can you make any sense of this? Aw, you're no help either.
How mighty convenient. Aren't you supposed to protect Steven or something?
Hmm? What? Where'd she...
Surprise!
How did she do that, and why did no one see her up until now? She was right behind Steven.
It took me months to stop trying to kill Steven.
I say it took me a day and a half.
Bismuth, you didn't start out wanting to kill Steven. That little moment lasted, what, 4 or 5 minutes?
Be careful with that. It's a rejuvenator.
Okay, wait a second. If Bismuth knew what a rejuvenator was, shouldn't the gems have known as well? And following that logic, if a weapon like this was around at the same time Bismuth was, you'd think that it would have been used sometime in the war on, well, rebels? If they weren't used, then that's incompetency on Homeworld's part. But if they were used, then how did the crystal gem still get hit by it? Movie's kinda messing with the continuity a bit, isn't it?
You're the one with healing powers. If anyone can fix this, it's you.
Except that he doesn't have them anymore. And even if he did, how would that help him?
Your new best friend. Your new best friend.
Your new best friend. Your new best friend. Spinel is here.
Here we are in the future.
Why did this need to be a song?
When has it ever been easy?
The past 2 years.
Here we are in the future.
Steven blatantly ignoring his friend's words just for the sake of continuing the song. Also, damn, Bismuth can sing.
As long as one of us is standing to brandish the star,
we'll find a way to save the day. That's who we are.
What if it's like a puzzle?
If we give them all the pieces, eventually they'll get the picture.
You might be onto something.
No, she isn't. I call bullshit on the fact that this actually works. Let's use a video game console as an example. Say, a Nintendo Switch? Say you have a save file of Super Mario Odyssey on it, and that save file is 100% complete. If you were to factory reset that console, that's it. All the games you played on it, all the save files you build up, it's all completely wiped. Even if you start playing Odyssey again, it's not like the Switch is gonna suddenly say, "Oh yeah, me and them played this already, I remember now," and bring all the save data back. It's gone. Permanently. Of course, this is taking into account that the data isn't backed up on Nintendo Switch Online or something, but that takes us back to here. The gems are essentially factory reset. Reliving memories or experiences that they've had has absolutely no chance of working because that shit was wiped clean. The only possible way this could work is if their memories are somehow saved outside of their gem, which I highly doubt because of what Bismuth said earlier.
Homeworld used to use these things on gems that started stepping out of line. One hit with this, you're back to how they made you.
Homeworld didn't need these gems to remember experiences. They didn't make them to feel anything. Homeworld made these gems to serve specific purposes, and everything else was irrelevant. Why would experiences be saved to their gem when experiences mean nothing to Homeworld? Sure, I'll give you the fact that they may become rebels again if the right experiences are relived. But I call horseshit on the idea that they would remember anything about what happened before they were factory reset. And I'm sorry, but this kind of destroys the plot. 20 sins, please.
Are you serious?
Why does this voice line sound like it was recorded from the inside of a washing machine?
That could take forever!
Even if it takes 1,000 years to get them back, we will.
Here we are in the future, yeah! Here we are in the future, and it's wrong!
The Spinel will pick up that device out of curiosity. Hijinks will ensue. In just a moment, the scaffolding will start falling all around you. Next, the Peridot will hold back some of the falling debris. 3 large barrels will fall. The Bismuth will catch 2 of them. The Lapis will rush in and save them at the last second.
The saw! The saw will continue to cut!
The anvil will fall, and you... you will be shattered!
Sapphire's future vision ruins this scene! All the action is literally spoiled for you, and all the excitement for what will happen next is completely destroyed for the sake of... a joke? A showing of her powers? No, there is no point. It's just shit. Also, Ruby, you can literally get out of there right now! Why are you just sitting there? You want to continue to protect the Sapphire, right? What if, right after you get shattered, someone shatters her too? Why are you so willing to die that you just do nothing? This is so stupid!
Suddenly hot, I'm...
Why did this need to be a song?
Attention, everyone! Greg Universe has arrived!
Steven! Ugh. Pearl, you don't have to do that! I own a car wash!
Yes, because how dare she help you?
Do you remember singing and dancing with me? In the light of the day, in the dark of the night.
See, this is how you introduce a song, not just shoving it in without warning. Not to mention, it's my fourth favorite song in the movie. It's really good.
When you're rising to shine.
When you're rising to shine.
How does one tap dance on concrete in sandals? Or even better, how does Amethyst tap dance with her bare feet?
With the way Steven's right arm is drawn here, his arm would have to be puncturing straight through his body to reach his other arm like that.
Who would ever have this long of a pin on their lock screen?
What are you doing here?
Let me explain.
Get away from him, you monster!
You heard Steven, right? He was talking pretty loudly. You're seriously just now figuring that out? Gone! How is he lifting this already?
Bismuth, Lapis, can't you lift that thing?
His gem powers are gone! How is he lifting this already?
Bismuth, Lapis, can't you lift that thing?
You think we didn't try that?
Disturbing the injector accelerates the poison's rate of release. Also, it might explode.
Okay, then here's what you do. Have Lapis use the ocean that is right next to you and lift the thing up safely using water. The drill isn't that deep in the ground, and I'm pretty sure the force of 321,003,271 cubic miles of water would be more than enough to move the drill. And that's considering you even have to use all of the ocean. Sure, there may be some flooding damage, but having Beach City be flooded is a much better alternative than having all organic life be destroyed. Beach City can be rebuilt. Lives can't. But no, let's try to spin some bullshit that we already tried that, despite the fact that water would very clearly work. Here's an idea. If it wouldn't work, show us how it doesn't work. Don't just leave us in the dark like that. Quit lying!
She's cute and harmless now, but if we bring her back, she'll kill us all!
You're going to die anyway, if you don't get her to deactivate that thing!
Peridot would be good at CinemaSins.
I'm afraid I can't help. I'm currently in the service of my Greg universe, preparing for tonight's concert.
It's literally just an explanation! Christ!
We need those for the show!
Who cares about the rock show? We have to stop Spinel's injector or everyone on Earth is going to die!
Steven would be good at CinemaSins. Again.
This has gotta bring Pearl's memories back.
Wait, what?
Good afternoon, sir. What can I do, sir? Just say the word, sir. Anything for you, sir. Your friends all say
this is the worst song in the movie. Firstly, let's just get this out of the way. In my opinion, this song is generic garbage. This sounds like some bullshit Linkin Park would sing, and it's really jarring compared to the other songs this show has put out. Secondly, what in the everlasting fuck made Steven think this song of all things would bring Pearl back? Knowing Pearl, she'd probably think this song is just regular human music and not even give it a second thought, not have some kind of personal connection to it. Why did Steven think this would trigger anything in Pearl? Just because it's about rebels? Hey, Steven, that's not how that works. Not to mention, this was a heavily missed opportunity to have Sadie Killer and the Suspects sing a song loved by the Steven Universe fandom. Like We Are the Crystal Gems, or What Can I Do For You, or Comet, or Do It For Her, or It's Over Isn't It. There's literally so much you could choose from that hits on the themes of rebellion or love and loss. This movie's for the fans, right? So why go with this random generic song? Oh, and Sadie's voice here? Nails on a fucking chalkboard.
Disobedient, disobedient, disobedient.
What the hell is this supposed to be?
You know, her original
disobedient, disobedient, disobedient.
What the hell is this supposed to be?
You know, her original boss, the love of her life, the reason she rebelled in the first place.
Just say rose quartz, Jesus.
Why does this movie not want to mention Rose by name? How did that work? You can't just go, oh, Steven's gone back to having no powers 1 minute, then for no reason go, oh, Steven's fusion powers are back, with no build-up in between. That's bullshit. Plus, how does Greg disappearing into the fusion even help Pearl's case anyway? If anything, Pearl shouldn't even be listening to a thing this fusion says and should just be looking for Greg. But no, gotta move that plot along in the most convenient yet ridiculous way possible. Plus, isn't this fusion a little too overly sexualized to be a fusion between a father and a son? This song's pretty good though, not gonna lie. They also picked a really good voice actor for... Stegs? Grievin? I don't fucking know, just take the damn sins off.
What do you want to do?
How does he have enough power left in his gem for this? The fusion is only 1/4 gem, and with the regression that Spinel put on him earlier, this really shouldn't work.
Are you sure you don't need a break?
I gotta do what I can with the little I have left.
You have 40-something hours. Calm down.
Just this morning, everything was perfect. Why did everything have to change?
This is the 10th time you've said this. We get it.
Is anything coming back to you? No!
This is either a really bad place to put that no, or she's lying. Proofreading, Crooniverse. It's a great thing. Also, I hate to be a broken record here, but as much as I love Spinel's backstory, there is absolutely no way Spinel should remember what happened with Pink Diamond due to the factory reset. I get I explained this earlier, but it's especially egregious here. Okay, these are just straight up SpongeBob's footsteps. Is this just a stock sound effect or something? Because surely they realize this.
Here in the garden, let's play a game.
This is my second favorite song in the movie, originally my favorite. I find it incredible that the Crooniverse was able to weave Spinel's character almost seamlessly into this universe, and completely turn Spinel into one of my favorite Steven Universe characters in just one song. While this still doesn't excuse how near unbearable Spinel was at the start, this song gave me new appreciation for her, and also really hits me hard on a personal level. I admit I'm biased, but the instrumental, the vocals, everything about this is just great. You know what's coming.
She doesn't exist now, survived by her son and all of her brand new friends.
Wait a second. After this message aired, Steven pretty much went straight back to Beach City, sang that song, gathered all the crystal gems, and I'm assuming Spinel attacked relatively soon after due to it still being daytime. So in those possible few hours, Spinel discovered Steven's live message, probably had a good long cry, underwent that transformation, went back to Homeworld, grabbed a rejuvenator, because I highly doubt something designed to be a diamond's playmate would carry a weapon on their own, grabbed a huge-ass drill, filled it with some kind of poison, and piloted it to Earth, which is confirmed to be quite a distance away. All of this in a matter of hours. I think you could see why I doubt the validity of that. Also, I swear the drums make this song clip or something, because Spinel's vocals seem to do this weird... stuttering thing?
I can't believe Mom did that to you. Actually, I can totally believe it. You're not the only one she hurt.
Wow, way to lessen what she went through, Steven.
Someday, somewhere, somehow, you'll love again.
And this is my favorite song in the entire movie. And it's currently in the running as my favorite song in the entire series. It's beautiful, it sends a really important message that I wish I had when I was younger. And, well, this is one of the sole things that makes the movie one of my favorite things to come out of Steven Universe. It just says so much using so little, and I love it for that. So just take some more off. I think the movie deserves it at this point.
All right, I'll wash my hands.
Is that all you needed me for? To turn off my injector?
No, well... sort of, but not-
But what now? I did what you wanted. That's it?
Well, yeah. We can just forget this whole thing ever happened.
Steven,
Buddy, did you ever realize how much of a fucking moron you are? You are literally the fucking talker, the one who knows how to make people feel better about themselves. Yet how do you react to Spinel asking you a pretty reasonable question? We sorta only needed you for the drill. Oh yeah, you only did what I wanted, that's it. Steven, you were literally watching her break down. Didn't the gears in your head start turning? And didn't you maybe think, perhaps I shouldn't insinuate that Spinel only had one use to me? Because that may be why she broke down in the first place.
Oh, but Supersonic, Steven is tired and stressed, and oh, woe is him. Why did things change? Why is his happily ever after gone? He wasn't thinking straight.
Change your mind. Steven's gem is out of his body. He is literally dying. Yet he still shows that he has room to care about the people in the room, including the person who ripped out his gem in the first place.
No, stop! You're hurting them!
Bad example? Bismuth. The episode, not the gem. A gem who he spent the entire day with is trying to shatter him. Despite being put on the back foot and having his life on the line, he is still choosing his words carefully and trying to talk Bismuth down.
Wait! I'm not my mom! I don't know what she did, but I'm sure she didn't want to hurt you!
Still a bad example? Gem Harvest. Steven is hanging on for dear life on Andy's plane. At any moment, he could lose his grip and fall into the ocean. But despite that, Steven still finds a way to come up with the right words to say to Andy.
Andy! I love that we both eat cake! And you have that cool hat! And you know how to peel potatoes! And you need a plane to fly! I love the gems, but I'm a human too! I never had a chance to know that part of my family, but now I do! Andy, I want to be your family! Isn't that why you came back?
Steven has plenty of experience with stressful and tiring situations. In each of these, either Steven, the gems, or both have been put into extreme danger, and at any point, Steven could have decided to stop talking nice and put his foot down. Yet Steven's skill in talking to others always shone through. So for Steven to completely brush off Spinel's problem, the very reason she snapped the way she did, when he even heard it straight from her, I'm sorry, but that's bullshit. That's not Steven's character. You wanna know what that is? A contrived, arbitrary plot device. 20 cents, please.
Why do you have that?
I was just carrying it. I didn't have anywhere else to put it.
No, Steven, that's not a fucking excuse. Why didn't you just throw that shit away? It's not like you were ever gonna need it for anything. God, this part's so contrived it hurts.
Get away from her.
And you're making it worse. Cool.
Oh, when a difficult day goes by.
This one's okay. It sounds nice and it's got a good rhythm to it, but compared to the others, I don't know, I just don't like it as much. It fits the situation, and it certainly isn't a case of why does this need to be a song, so... fine, let's just take a few off. Also, it sure is mighty convenient that the Crystal Gems could suddenly fight off Spinel like she's nothing. You know literally nothing more about her than you knew before, and she was giving you a hell of a hard time earlier. Not to mention, you've been incapacitated for quite a while. What makes this time different? Is smooth jazz really the best fit for this situation?
You can't fight her.
But I can still talk to her.
Yeah, look at how well that went the first time. How is he climbing this? This is pure smooth glass. Unless there's some kind of indentation he's sticking his fingers in somehow.
It's the truth.
Okay, Steven's gotta have some kind of suction cups on his hands or something.
Spinel, this isn't a game!
Yeah, talk down to her like she's a child! That'll really help your case.
All this happily ever after stuff has made me forget the first power I ever had. The power to change.
Yeah, no. That's not how that works. Steven was never the type of character to get so caught up in his own fantasies of a happy ending that he just flat out ignored other people's struggles. That's a thing you introduced, Crooniverse. You guys suddenly had Steven disregard Spinell's past for... what? A quick lesson? A contrived issue that Steven never had in the first place?
It doesn't matter how much you try to push this as Steven going through some kind of character arc.
You changed Steven's base characteristics, just so this plot can happen. That's bad writing. Stop trying to justify it.
I can make a promise.
Why did this need to be a song? What's the point of these bubble boxing gloves? It's not like you're gonna try to punch her back or anything, so why not just use the shield? What's the point of the heuristics? Just so this plot can happen. That's bad writing. Stop trying to justify it.
I can make a promise.
Why did this need to be a song? What's the point of these bubble boxing gloves? It's not like you're gonna try to punch her back or anything, so why not just use the shield?
Spinell's gem isn't upside down in this shot.
You can't just make everything better by singing some stupid song!
This entire movie is summarized in this one sentence.
I'll be right back. Really?
Yeah, okay, you still haven't learned a thing. Just have her come with you, Jesus Christ!
I wish I could just start from scratch with somebody.
Knock knock, Steven!
It's us!
The Diamonds!
Diamond Ex Machina. Been a while since I had to dust that one off.
It's been so boring since you've left. I guess we'll just wait for you to visit us whenever you're ready.
Come live with us in the palace.
God damn it, not again! Oh, and why did this need to be a song? Yeah, I almost forgot that one.
Here we are in the future.
I just can't fucking escape it! Why did this need to be a song? At least this should be the last one.
I can make a change. Here we are.
Yikes. Zach, buddy. That high note wasn't very graceful. What the hell am I looking at right now?
Happily ever after never ends.
Except that you just said a little bit earlier that Happily Ever After pretty much doesn't exist, and that whole Spinell arc was nowhere near Happily Ever After, and... oh, just fuck it. I've already crucified myself enough already by daring to criticize Steven Universe. Alright, well, that was a good movie, just very flawed in some areas. There, I finally did a recent episode... movie... thing. This was one of the most exhausting and hardest scripts I've ever had to write, so I guess we'll see how much Tumblr and Reddit hate it. It might take me another few weeks before everything wrong with Steven Universe fully comes back, but I wanted to do something more recent for a while, and well, here we are. Hope you guys enjoyed.
Thank you.